Hello, I'm Colin Daly of Campbell Scientific in Logan, Utah. In this video, we'll show you how to get your Solar 800 up and running in no time. Let's go inside to do the configuration. Your Solar 800 will come in four boxes. Here's the enclosure. Inside are the quick start guide and calibration sheets. You'll also need power. We'll find the battery in box 4. My Solar 800 has the Ethernet kit, so I've already talked to our IT department about getting assigned either a static IP address or a DHCP. Thank you. Looks like they've assigned me a static IP address for the Solar 800. I'll keep this for later. We'll switch on the power supply here. I'll connect my computer to the RS232 port here. And I've already installed the Solar 800 configuration utility on my computer. Let's take a look. Select your communications port. My USB to serial connection is on COM5. Now connect. The configuration utility checks to see if there are already settings on your Solar 800. This takes a few seconds. Now you'll start the configuration process for a new installation, or edit settings if the Solar 800 has been set up previously. I'll call this station Solar 800 Tutorial. Your data file name will also include this, so use something meaningful, such as a location or a project identifier. Select the Measurements tab next. The first item is how often you'll store the data. 10 minutes is a typical interval. This Solar 800 has the Advanced Meteorological Measurements. The Advanced Meteorological Measurements includes relative humidity and barometric pressure, in addition to the standard measurements of temperature, wind speed, wind direction, precipitation, and global and plane of array irradiance. For both the standard and advanced measurements, you'll need some pyranometer calibration numbers. These are on the calibration certificate we pulled out earlier. They're also marked on the sensors themselves. Make note on the calibration sheets which sensors will be mounted horizontally and which will be mounted in the plane of array. Enter the horizontal or GH sensitivity first. Tab will move you to the next field. Enter the POA or plane of array sensitivity. When you're done there, go to the Location tab. Here, enter site-specific information. The values I'm using are for Logan, Utah. Note that the elevation is in meters. To convert from feet to meters, divide by 3.28. If you're going to run your Solar 800 on local time, you'll need to enter the UTC offset for your time zone when on standard time. For example, this station is in the mountain time zone, so it will have a UTC offset of -7. If you plan on running your Solar 800 on UTC, make sure a 0 is entered for the UTC offset. We'll describe how to set the clock of the Solar 800 later on. The UTC offset can be applied by clicking the up or down arrow until you get to the correct value, or entering it directly. The Solar 800 can automatically adjust its clock for daylight saving time in the US if desired. Set the daylight saving clock adjustment setting to true to enable automatic daylight saving time adjustment. If your Solar 800 is going to run on UTC time, be sure to select false. When that's done, go to the Network tab. My Solar 800 has the Ethernet kit, so I'll select True. This is where I'll use the information provided by my IT department. I'll enter the static IP address here. Yours will be different. The IP gateway here, and the subnet mask here. Contact your IT department for the appropriate domain name servers. For this installation, I'll use Google's domain name servers. Now we'll configure our email settings. Since I do want the Solar 800 to automatically send an email message with my data every day, I'll enable these settings. I'll set the time to 0 so the Solar 800 will send the day's data at midnight. This is where I enter my email address. Use a comma to separate multiple email addresses. The from email address identifies the particular installation. Again, it would make sense to give it a meaningful name, such as location or project. I'll use Solar800 Tutorial. Next, you'll enter the configuration settings of your email server. You might have to ask your IT department for this if you're using your organization's server. And also make sure that these emails don't get blocked. I set up a Gmail account for all my Solar800s to use. This is where you enter the username associated with your email server. Mine is csisolar800@gmail.com. Enter your email account password. Now we'll move on to configuring our FTP settings. Again, you will either need to set up or have your IT department set up the FTP site where you will upload your data files. Select True to enable the FTP settings. And enter your FTP server address. I set my username when I configured the server. Again, the password was set up when I configured the FTP server. This directory is optional but useful, especially if you have multiple sites. We're almost done. On this tab, set your Modbus and DNP addresses. These will depend on the SCADA system you're interfacing with. Now we'll save those settings for the Solar800. Don't worry, you can go back and change anything if you need to. It takes a minute or so for the Solar800 to incorporate the settings. When it's done, you'll get a confirmation. Make sure it says your Solar800 program is running. Now let's set the clock and make sure we have the email and FTP settings right. Be patient here while the Solar800 configuration utility reads the settings from the Solar800 itself. This takes a few seconds. I'll set the Solar800's clock on the Logger Control tab. You can see your computer's time here, and the Solar800 time here, and how much difference there is between them here. Click the Set Clock button to set the station time to the reference or computer time. The Solar800 will automatically adjust for daylight saving time. Now we'll check the email and FTP functions. Select Public. These are your real-time values. Because your sensors aren't connected yet, many measurement values will either read NaN, meaning not a number, or have an unrealistic value for now. Here's the test email control. Double-click or press F2 to edit. Type in any non-zero number and enter. Now watch the email status field. It'll change from idle to pending to success, hopefully. It will say failed if it didn't work. Be patient here, as some email servers take longer than others to respond. Check your email and its junk folder to confirm receipt. Now we'll test the FTP function the same way. Double-click or press F2 and enter a non-zero number. Watch the FTP status field. It looks like we did not have success here, so let's go check our settings. Go back to Configuration and FTP. Here's my problem. I have the wrong password. I can easily fix that by typing in the correct one. We need to save or apply these changes. Be patient here. It takes about 60 seconds for the Solar800 to compile the program. Make sure your program is running. Then we can test our FTP settings again. Go to the Data Monitor tab. Double-click or press F2. Type in a non-zero number and enter. This time we have success. Check your FTP site to make sure your file is written as expected. This last step that I'm going to show you is optional, but recommended. Back up your Solar800. The Solar800 configuration utility makes it easy. Click on the Backup menu item, Backup Data Logger, and step through the wizard. Here, all the files on the CPU should be selected. Now you'll have a zip file on your computer with all your Solar800 settings documented should you ever need to recover them. After configuration is complete, switch off the power supply to preserve your battery and disconnect your USB to RS-232 cable. please contact a Campbell Scientific application engineer to discuss your application and for answers about getting your Solar 800 configured.